Carla with Raised to Walk, and today we're going to be talking about why it's important that churches have good libraries. But first, before we get started, a little bit about this channel. Here we share good thoughts about good words, and on Tuesdays I publish videos about books, and on Fridays I host a live Bible study on Instagram at Raised to Walk, and then I upload that here later to YouTube. So if that any of that is interesting to you, be sure to like and subscribe and hit the bell for notifications so you can get updates on new videos. So here's the thing. Right now I live in Texas, and South has very big churches, and I go to a very big church, but the church that I currently go to does not have a library, and they also don't have a prayer room. They used to have both, but they had to use that space for offices and something else, and so we have neither now, which personally I see as pretty big deficiencies on both sides. So I was talking to one of our family pastors about that, and he said, oh well, I've never been in a church that has a library. And I was thinking, what? That is just weird. I mean, I thought that we just didn't have a library because they needed the space and had never found another spot for one. I didn't realize that was just a thing, that some churches don't have it. Because, I'm from the Northwest. I didn't go to churches that were near the size as the one I'm going to now, or that most churches are here in the South. But every church that I ever went to in the Northwest had a library. It was at one of those churches that was from their library that I discovered C.S. Lewis and George MacDonald and some really, really great writers. And then for a little while, we went to my grandma's church, the Church of Nazarene, and it was like tiny, tiny church, like maybe 20 people coming. It just had like a worship center, and then there was just like this kind of long room where they had a table where they would have potlucks, and their library was basically a half bookshelf that had books in it, but at least they had something. I remember checking out books from that library. There are different stories by different missionaries. And so even that small of a church had something. They had something. I mean, the other church that I went to where I found all those books, it wasn't huge. It was actually kind of half library and half, bookstore. And they didn't have a huge bookstore either. But at least it had something. And so I'm going to tell you why it's important. Now, I'm going to read from A Dish of Words by George MacDonald, the same passage I read from in my 5 fictional love stories that I hate, my little rant on that. But I think that it's really, really important, and George MacDonald has some really good insights on that. So in this, he talks about how important reading good books are. And this is from his essay on the imagination, its functions, and its culture. And he writes, in books we not only have store of all results of imagination, but in them, as in her workshop, we may behold her embodying before our very eyes. In music of speech, in wonder of words, tell her work like a golden dish set with shimmering jewels and adorned by the hands of the cunning workman stands finished before us. In this kind, then, the best must be set before the learner, that he may eat and not be satisfied, for the finest products of the imagination are of the best nourishment for the beginnings of that imagination. And the mind of the teacher must mediate between the work of art and the mind of the pupil, bringing them together in vital contact of intelligence, directing the observation to the lines of expression, the points of force, and helping the mind to repose upon the whole, so that no separable beauty shall lead to a neglect of the scope, that is, the shape or form complete. And he must ever seek to show excellence rather than talk about it, giving the thing itself, that it may grow into the mind, and not a eulogy of his own upon the thing, isolating the point worthy of remark, rather than making many remarks upon the point. And then further down he writes, thus doing he shall perform the true office of friendship. He will introduce his pupil into the society which he himself prizes most, surrounding him with the genial presence of the high-minded, that this good company, may work its own kind in him who frequents it. But he will likewise seek to turn him aside from such company, whether of books or of men, as might tend to lower his reverence, his choice, or his standard. He will therefore discourage indiscriminate reading, and that worse than waste, which consists in skimming the books of a circulating library. He knows that if a book is worth reading at all, it is worth reading well, and that if it is not worth reading, it is only to the most accomplished reader that it can be worth skimming. He will seek to make him discern not merely between the good and the evil, but between the good and the not so good. And this not for the sake of sharpening the intellect, still less of generating that self-satisfaction which is the closest attendant upon criticism, but for the sake of choosing the best path and the best companions on it. We'll go out and look at the young adult books out there. There is just so much really gross stuff in it. It's kind of shocking how far it has devolved. Talking with one of my friends, and we were in a discussion about, you know, young adult books, and somebody said that publishers are actually looking for those types of yuck stuff to promote it. And reading is important. And, you know, when I look back on the books that I read, especially George MacDonald, I can see how he had such a huge influence on just not only how I see books as a whole, but also, you know, just some of the ideas that I had. You know, people read stories, they're picking up ideologies beneath them. And C.S. Lewis called that, you know, sneaking past watchful dragons. And when he was referring to it, he was referring to, you know, when he wrote his Narnia stories, he was wrapping the story of the gospel in his fiction. But the opposite is also true. You know, there's in all these other books, there's these underlying ideologies, and kids are picking those up without even knowing it's something that they need to evaluate. And, you know, we do have, like here locally, we do have really great public libraries, but you know what? They're not curated for the best. There is a wide, wide selection. And so I know that so many churches and so many parents are so concerned about, you know, being able to establish your children's faith so that it will stand. And they're worried about, you know, they focus on arguments and, you know, reasons for the gospel and reasons for God. And all those things are good. But I think there's this huge gap when we don't help them learn how to choose what is good, how to choose those good companions, how to evaluate books like, okay, well, what is the author? What is the worldview of the author here? What is it they're really saying? Because those ideas are there the whole time. And I think that churches, if they're not developing a library and encouraging their members to make use of it and explore those good books, you're missing a huge, huge, huge opportunity to help cultivate the mind, you know, because the Bible says we're supposed to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, and we're supposed to tear down those false imaginations. And so imagination is important. It helps us build our faith, and it helps us learn how to connect to God, but it needs to be a good imagination. And we need to be able to recognize those good things and reject things that aren't good. So, you know, another thing that I think would be a good idea, not only for adults, but for kids, is to have a book club. We actually had at my daughter's elementary school, they had this thing called Book and a Bite, and it was for, I think, fifth graders. And it was a really cool idea. So what they would do is they would pick a book, and it was like child and parent, and everyone would read the book in the month before, and then when they came, they would bring a snack. And so my daughters were always really into it, and I thought it was a great idea. It's just that the teachers that were running it would like change the date at the last minute, so we didn't last very long, because it's like one time we got there, and then, you know, they had literally sent an email at the last minute, and they had changed the date. And I was like, okay, forget this. I mean, I was a single mom. I mean, I can't just drop things on a dime and change it. I need to be able to schedule and plan. So Booking a Bite didn't last very long for us at the elementary school, but I do think the concept is really good and it can be really fun. And, you know, if you had these, if you're able to pick those good books and those good imaginative books that kids would like, or that, and just be able to discuss them and talk about those things that are good. And if you're thinking, well, I don't know how to evaluate some of those things, guess what? I have a resource for you. You can go to an Unexpected Journal, and we talk about all kinds of books. We talk about movies. We talk about a lot of popular stories. And if you need some advice and tips, go there. And we probably have someone that has written on it. If you don't find something, then the contact page, send us a message and suggest a topic for an issue. We have 2020 lined out, but you know, before too long, we're going to be working out our editorial plan for 2021, which is crazy. So anyway, that's enough for today. And I would like to know if your church has a library. It doesn't have to be big. Like I said, my grandma's church, half bookshelf, but they had a library. So let me know. But anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.